Hey, hello and welcome. Between a rock and a hard place, reducing carbon footprint, the post-COVID-19 challenge. That is the discussion of that we are focusing on today. Welcome to all of you from the Ananta Aspen Center and India Spend. Now, we're all fighting and grappling with the coronavirus crisis. And some of us, not me so much, but my guests for sure, are actually thinking about what is life likely to be and or should be the post-coronavirus environment or world. Now, that does not mean the virus is going to go away, but clearly there are some changes that have been triggered by the virus and the way it has swept the whole world. And perhaps we could use this either as an opportunity or to reshape some things that we do or have been doing as businesses, individuals, or even governments. There are three guests that we have, all extremely experienced and prolific from their worlds, and who will, I'm sure, bring a wealth of experience and understanding into this discussion and debate. So let me introduce them very quickly and also tell you how we're going to go about it. First is Dr. O.P. Agarwal, the Chief Executive Officer of World Resources Institute in India. He is he was a member of the Indian Administrative Service from 1979 to 2007. And part of the Assam cadre. He's held several positions both under the central government and the government of Assam, including being the joint secretary in charge of urban transport in the Ministry of Urban Development and secretary for transport in Assam. He was the principal author of the National Urban Development, Urban Transport Policy for the country, which was adopted in 2006 and has remained a key document guiding urban transport investment since then. He has worked with the World Bank for 6 years as its global urban transport advisor in Washington, D.C. He has a PhD from the Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, and a master's degree in transportation from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, or MIT, and a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from the Indian Institute of Technology, Madras. Dr. Aniruddha Agnihotri is the head of environmental sustainability, health and safety for Tata Consultancy Services, or TCS, India's largest IT company. He has a PhD in environmental science and engineering from the Indian Institute of Technology, Mumbai, an MS in environmental engineering from the Johns Hopkins University, USA, and over 25 years of postdoctoral professional experience in corporate sustainability and environment, health and safety. And his areas of interest include developing strategy on sustainability, climate change and health and safety and monitoring performance. And finally, Harish Hande, let me add quickly the locations because I think it's useful to know. Dr. Agarwal is in New Delhi, Dr. Aniruddha Agnihotri is in Mumbai, and Harish Hande, who we will go over to now, is in Boston, United States. He is the founder and chief executive of Selco Foundation, a renewable energy entrepreneur who, with over 25 years of grassroots experience in meeting energy needs of underserved populations. Harish is also the founder of Selco India, a pioneering last mile rural energy enterprise based in India since the early 90s. And his focus is on increasing incomes, improving quality of lives, and alleviating poverty, turning energy consumers into asset owners. Now, Selco, established in 95, runs grassroots operations, which you must be or have perhaps heard of, which sell, install, and service decentralized energy solutions like solar light systems for households, institutions, digital education, livelihood appliances, and financed, interestingly, by local financial institutions. Harish is a graduate of the Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur, and a master's and PhD from the University of Massachusetts, in Boston, I'm assuming. And Harish was conferred in 2011 the Ramon Magsaysay Award in recognition of his vision to catalyze development outcomes via sustainable energy. So there you are, three IITs and MITs, or one MIT, and all essentially far more qualified than I am here. So my name is Govind Raj Yathiraj. I'm mostly a financial journalist, but now focused more on journalism in the public interest space and fighting misinformation. So we want to talk about two or three things. So one is, what are the post-COVID-19 challenges and opportunities from a carbon footprint point of view? What is it that we can do, should be doing, and also trying to move towards policy action at a time like this, which is a very, very useful time to trigger, as I mentioned earlier. And finally, how do we do it in a manner that is sustainable and we do not all hit the reverse gear and when things become okay, whether we find a cure or a vaccine, or we just forget about things and go back to normal, which I'm feeling like right now in the city of Mumbai, considering we've been focused more on a cyclone and heavy rain. So thank you very much once again for all the participants who are joining in. Do remember that we have lots of time for your questions and comments, and I really hope to make this an interesting discussion. So with that, let me ask Dr. O.P. Agarwal to kick off with his opening remarks, and then we will bring in the other two guests, followed by a conversation. Thank you.
Thanks, Govind, and hello to everyone. As Govind has introduced me more on a mobility perspective, I'm going to talk more from a mobility perspective. But the way I see it is COVID-19 is really a jolt to us. You know, it's really an opportunity for us to step back and start thinking of what is it that we've been doing wrong. We know we've been doing it wrong, but we haven't, you know, inertia or whatever it is, has not persuaded us to change things. I think this is the opportunity for us to say, hey, now this is the time to change things. You won't get this kind of an opportunity again. But what COVID-19 has shown us, to my mind, from a mobility perspective, are two major things that we can take advantage of. One is a recognition that there are many things we have been doing for which we used to travel. It's really not necessary to undertake a trip for carrying out those things. So it's not just work from home, but a whole lot of other things that we have now over the last 2 months begun to realize that we don't have to travel for doing these things. I think the need for reducing the number of trips we make, the need to reduce travel demand, I think that is one trend that will pick up going forward. That's one. The second is this whole concern about social distancing. Whether it's going to last for the next 2 months or going to last for the next 6 months or last for the next 2 years, at this point, we don't really know. But this concern about social distancing is likely to impact travel patterns and particularly public transport systems. Now, for the last 60 years, I think the first game started somewhere in the 1960s in UK, but a recognition that we cannot meet all our travel demand only through a personal motor vehicle, but need to start shifting towards public transport. That effort of 60 years, which many countries have been following and trying to promote public transport, is that going to start getting reversed because social distancing is going to become a concern? What may complement all of that is the fact that public transport systems financially are already on treacherous ground. They're already on vulnerable ground. And if you see lowered riderships, is that going to make the financial systems even worse for public transport? I think this is the opportunity to start looking at how we finance public transport. Is all the money going to come only from fares, or are there other options that are available, which we know about, but we haven't really leveraged? Is it something that we can start doing right now so that financial public transport systems can become financially much better off, with the result they could give us much better quality, and with the result that we can actually start seeing more people using them, even if the numbers per vehicle come down? I think these two trends of the reduced number of trips that people have to make and the concern about social distancing leading to more innovative financing patterns and thereby better public transports will be two kinds of things that we should really be looking at going forward. I think in this whole game, this issue of electric mobility, which has picked up, I think there are opportunities for electric mobility also as we go forward on this. And the reason I'm saying electric mobility is a good option in this situation is I see a lot of trips that will be made, even though the number of trips will be fewer. The other thing that I see happening is many of these trips will be shorter trips. And if they are shorter trips, are there options for electrically driven micro mobility options to start picking space? And if they can even be sort of energized through renewable sources in local communities, I think that is a real win-win, and that is the kind of direction we should be moving towards. So let me leave my opening remarks with that, Govind. So I'll take any questions after that.
Right. Thank you for that. Dr. Agnihotri, it's over to you.
Yeah, thanks, Govind. And good morning to all the viewers. Thanks, Dr. Agarwal, for that, very, very interesting topic that you opened your remarks with. So I come from the information services, information technology and services organization. And I think the COVID situation has taken us also by surprise. I mean, however, being in the IT sector, I think that has probably impacted us far lesser than most others, because being the nature of business that we are, we were capable of, you know, working remotely. And I think the first thing that we did once the lockdown started is had people start working from home. I think we moved a lot of our assets, IT assets, to people's homes, and we enabled a concept called SBWS, which is secure borderless workplaces, to ensure that our business interruptions were not there, or like at a minimum. So I think we were probably much better positioned, and I think the speed at which we could do that was really phenomenal. Within a couple of weeks, we had people working from their homes, and currently we are at about 95% people who are working from home. So I think to just give a background on the carbon footprint, I mean, coming back to the topic of carbon footprint, the earlier scenario was very different. Earlier we still have, of course, large campuses, large buildings, offices, which operate, almost 24/7. And there we have people going to work. And we were in the, we were monitoring our carbon footprint through these operations. So in the standard reporting format, which WRI themselves have, put out the GHG protocol, we're following the scope 1, scope 2, scope 3 standard, accounting practices for carbon footprint. And everything was going hunky-dory when we had mastered the art of accounting, reporting, and so on. And now we have this. We have now, our facilities, I would say around 120, 130 odd offices across India. And of course, globally, around 180 offices globally. We are operating from hardly a few of the offices, because most of them are into lockdown. So in India, we would be operating, say, around, or not fully operating yet, but still ramping up operations at about 20 to 30 offices across India. And hence we are at a crossroad now as how do we account for our carbon footprints? And I think that is the conundrum perhaps that we are at, and we're trying to still wrap our heads around the accounting process and all that. And we are hopeful that GHG protocol will come up with guidelines and protocols to really account for this, because almost all people are at home, 95% people are at home. And even in offices, I think not more than 1-2% people are working from offices. So the entire operations at our campuses has actually ramped down. So I think that is the situation. I just wanted to, illustrate the situation we are in currently. And I'll close my opening remarks here. And, other things we can discuss as we go along in the Q&A section. Thank you. Go ahead.
Thank you very much, Dr. Agnihotri. It's over to you, Harish.
Thanks, Ravindra. Yes, I'm stuck in Boston, hopefully waiting for my first flight out and to be quarantined back in Bangalore. Yes, the situation for us has been what I see in our sector of energy access, there's been a collapse. There will be, and there has been a collapse of the last mile entrepreneurs and enterprises, unfortunately. And so what we are pushing for, saying that rather than saying too big to fail, we need to look for too valuable to fail. For example, if the street vendors, for example, completely disappear, the cost of vegetables for the poor is going to increase. Same way, if the small and medium enterprises who provide energy access services to the poor collapse, then the cost of providing essential services like energy, water, will go drastically high. And that's a danger. And that's why we're pushing for the concept. It's too valuable to make sure that they save. It's like you have a a rusted nail on your finger. And if you don't give tetanus right now, you're going to cut off the arm, and that's going to be more expensive for all of us to provide essential services to the poor. And that's the danger that we are facing, that it's heartbreaking, because a lot of these enterprises come and say, a lot of our employees are without food, etc. And that's hit us in the energy access area very much. But coming to the post-COVID, I would say this is a chance to look at decentralized energy and decentralized manner of governance and democratization, creating 100 kilometers, 150 kilometers of islands where We push for now with so many people who have gone in, who have migrated, and the whole situation that we have in our country. Why not we use this as a chance to create decentralized livelihoods, decentralized way of everything in terms of energy access, in terms of health, education, livelihoods, in a manner that you create these islands where of pockets of self-sustainability, reducing consumption overall that we have been speaking for centuries, saying that's or for decades that's and create livelihoods using, whether it's a blacksmith blower, whether it's a silk weaving, the rice mills, in the fashion whether what Manipur wants, what Meghalaya wants, what Orissa wants, what Jharkhand wants. You create those pockets of decentralization, and that's a perfect you can't get a more perfect time than to look at sustainability and social sustainability. Automatically you're talking of carbon footprint to be reduced without taking the name carbon footprint. And that's, I think, is a chance that we have, and I hope we don't miss it, because you can't get a better chance than this, Gomin, right now. Thanks, Gomin. Over to you. And that's where I think without taking the name carbon footprint, we have come to a situation. You've been given in a platter to change it. I think we should not miss it.
Right. Thank you, Harish, for that. And thank you all for your short opening remarks. Not that I wanted it to be short, but anyway. So let me begin with you, Mr. Agarwal. So I think one is, we are looking at a conundrum, and in the context of mobility, you said that there may be a private desire to obviously have more, let's say, four vehicles or even four wheelers, and as a way to escape and say self and remain self-contained. And on the other hand, you are also obviously wanting to, or we want to have more public transport. So do you see this conflict increasing?
No, I don't see a conflict increasing. All I'm trying to say is as we see a reduced demand for transport, the public transport systems don't have to be what we are seeing of them today. You know, a public transport system need not be a metro system that will carry 1,200 people at a time. But we need to start thinking of newer mobility systems that are, one, more cost-effective and are more efficiently used. So I see a change in the kind of public transport systems, or, you know, instead of calling them mass transit as we call them today, they could be simpler mobility solutions. So you would have a larger number of people traveling short distances. Maybe just the neighborhood, you know, 1 or 2 kilometers away, which someone 15 years ago, I wouldn't have hesitated walking 2 kilometers. Today, I may not want to walk 2 kilometers in this heat, but I would much rather take a small, you know, small mini bike or something and just take it there. You know, that kind of a thing would meet my needs. And I think going further into what Harish said, I completely agree with him that this is really the opportunity to start looking at decentralized setups. And in decentralized setups, your trip lengths are also small. And those kind of trip lengths can be met through these simpler solutions. We don't need as much. So I really don't see a conflict between the two.
Yeah. So, and it's also, I mean, you're also, the premise here is that most people travel most of the time because they're going to workplaces.
Because that's the only way they knew they could work. Today, I mean, Dr. Agnihotri also mentioned this, what they are doing. I think a lot of people have begun to realize that it's not just working from home. There again, let me qualify this, that working from home is something that some professions could do. Everyone can't do that. You know, there are many who still have to go to work. You know, the last mile service delivery that Harish was talking about can't happen from home. So you will have people going to work. But there will be not an insignificant number that could work from home. But more than working from home, it's a whole lot of other things. You know, you want to order groceries, you want to order certain other things. You don't necessarily have to go to a place to get it. It gets delivered to you. And then can we look at delivery mechanisms which are more efficient in terms of carbon footprint than individual families or individuals going to a place to buy stuff and come back? I think this is also an opportunity to look at how our freight delivery systems work.
Right. And the push for that, obviously, I mean, one solid push for that will come because companies like TCS will say that in by 2025, I want 75% of my staff to be sitting at home. I mean, not figuratively, but literally. So Dr. Agnihotri, so how are you seeing this? If you were to pick up these two points, what Harish said about decentralization And what Dr. Agarwal said about the reduced mobility or the reduced need for mobility, how does it fit with what you are actually doing and planning to do?
Yeah. So I think what Dr. Agarwal said and what even Harish said, I think what we're looking at is now essentially decentralization. So instead of having a campus which is say housing 25,000 people at one go, I think what we are looking at is basically a decentralized system. We may not need such large campuses going forward. We may be able to consolidate. We may be able to get all people in a single campus and maybe rationalize our entire real estate portfolio, and which is essentially the decentralization that Harish talked about. And definitely the need for mobility will go down, because this is the IT folks who keep traveling across the city, crisscrossing the city at various times of the day. So like our BPO staff, BPS staff, works in shifts. So I think if you're able to bring all that need for traveling to a workplace down by a significant amount. So I think I definitely see that is going to have a huge impact, at least on the travel part of the carbon footprint. See, the carbon footprint is not only on account of the miles that people travel, it's also the traffic congestion, the slow moving traffic, the increase in the emissions because of low speeds and so on. I think that is going to have a compounding effect on the way we at least look at the commuting part of carbon emissions. Just one more point.
Yeah.
So in terms of the international travel that Dr. Agarwal also mentioned, that I think the need for traveling internationally also will go down significantly. I think a large part of our scope 3 emissions, which is the international travel, or even domestic travel that comes from the travel. So I think once that goes down, once the need for being physically present in a place goes down, I think we'll be seeing a lot of reduction in our scope 3 emissions as well, which is attributable to commuting as well as to the air travel.
Right. So just to go over that number that you mentioned earlier, you said you have 180 offices globally and 130 to 140 in India. Is it 180 plus 140, or is it 140?
No, it's all put together. And these are approximate numbers. I don't want, I'm not quoting them, offhand, but I think that is the rough number I would like to.
So roughly, you have 180 offices globally. Yeah. Is what you said. Now, so my question is, I mean, I know it's a little early to compute, but what is the reduction of energy usage in just the last 60 days in these 180 offices?
Yeah, so I think we are still getting accustomed to the way of monitoring, and since a lot of our facilities were actually down because lights were on, we had to keep the lights running. So there has been some consumption on that account. Some offices which were smaller and which were not operational, they have been shut down. So I think it is still too early to put a number on that.
Yeah.
But I would easily estimate it would be around half of the earlier consumption. But I think the numbers could vary from place to place, from a campus to campus. But on average, that would be the reduction. And now people, when they work from home, so it's not as if, because there is nobody working in the office, it doesn't mean it goes down to zero or to five or 10, because people are still connected to the office through their own individual laptops or desktops. There is a server which is running in the facility. There are, other equipment which are running to maintain those connections and the networks. So there is still some consumption. So I think that is the rough estimate, but I wouldn't like to be quoted on that. It's probably too early to estimate how much it is and how much is the reduction.
Dr. Agarwal, do we have a larger, more like a countrywide view of this? I mean, if we were to, I know it's still early days, but any guesstimates on what is the energy consumption reduction in the last 60 days? And then, of course, maybe if you could speculate a little bit on what it could be going forward, considering that many companies like TCS have decided that this is largely going to be the way forward.
See, I don't know if there's any national level assessment of this at all.
Yeah.
But the way I look at it is, I think with TCS, yes, they have fairly large servers, but they have to keep working at a central place. In an organization like ours, we don't have that. So in our office, it's completely zero. There's nothing, no energy consumption at all. Of course, I'm consuming more electricity at home because I'm working from here. But I think there's still, you know, huge efficiencies if you continue working here. The other thing I wanted to mention at this stage, you know, in the optimal utilization of assets, I think that also leads to some energy savings. For me, I would leave for office at about 8:30 in the morning, come back, say, at about 6:30. For those 10 hours, the house is completely empty. My office is occupied. 6:30 in the evening to 8:30 in the morning, the office is completely vacant. The house is occupied. I think there are two very different assets, both with their own parking spaces, which are not used for half the day. Now, that is suboptimal use of assets. Today, with the work from home, I think I'm using one asset more intensively. The other asset is available for something else. And for a mobility person, I look at it as a parking space which is not used. I can use it for some affordable housing or some planting of trees, which has probably got a carbon benefit as well. So I think on the energy consumption side, you will have some savings because offices are not working, but there will be increased consumption at home. But then overall, I think the optimization in the use of assets will itself lead to a number of benefits from a, you know, energy consumption point.
Okay, so I'm going to come back to you, Dr. Agarwal and Dr. Agnihotri. How do we create the demand pull for this or some of these things, including micro-mobility? Harish, you know, you talked about too big to fail and too valuable to fail. And that's a very, very important point. And this is, it is an outcome of coronavirus, but is not necessarily because of coronavirus.
Right.
So how do we now, you know, break this down, and how do we use this to really, one is to help people who need help, and then use the opportunities that are created.
Yeah, and more so, because see, a lot of people have been paint, for example, paintbrushing, like the migrants are moving back and etc. But there are different ages of migrants moving back. I mean, you have 0 to 5, 5 to 12, 12 to 17, 17 to above migrants moving back. So let's look at, concentrate on the 12 to 18 who are a future, what you call in the next 4 years are going to be an asset to the country. How are we going to utilize their services in an innovative manner? And this is where I think the not only for income generating activities that you need to create in the rural areas where people have moved back or people are starving of income generating, you have a chance for democratizing innovation also today. Because also it pushes today the question of, do we need to have one standard place where you manufacture all and then supply? That means you're forcing the world to look at using same things everywhere in the name of scale up. Today, I think this has also pushed us to look at decentralization of innovation and using this talent that is now there between 20 to 17, can we democratize innovation one way or the other, where you have, like, rather than have IITs the only place where you have centers of innovation and incubation, can we democratize, use the vocational schools of ITIs and root sets of centers of innovation and incubation, right, leading to such and that what will happen is, you create decentralized SMEs and use the rural banking systems to finance and create equity and grants for these SMEs that are graduating from here, leading to a very robust SME base, which need not be disrupted because of a large pandemic like this, or the crisis that we all are not thinking about is climate.
Right.
And I think together we should be, we need to look at the small SMEs to be too valuable to fail. And and we have the infrastructure in our country like ours, like the rural banks, the rural ITIs, the root cities, where more monies need to be put in, like the failure monies.
Harish, can you illustrate that with an example of a company, sector, industry, where, let's say, a first step could be taken?
For example, let's take of Meghalaya or Manipur. Meghalaya one. And then I will also pick up a place like Gulbarga, where there has been where migrants have moved back in many ways, right? So I would say there, if you look at the four or five Grameen banks in both areas, the RRBs, the regional rural banks, which need to be influxed with a lot of low interest debt, and along with that incentives, just like, I mean, really, I mean, one moment I talk about subsidies, a lot of people get up and say, is that Mark? But it's okay for us to talk about big companies not paying rents to in SEZ zones, but that's not considered subsidy, but that's considered tax incentives and whatever you call it in whatever balance sheet, but that subsidy end of the day. If similar subsidies were given to the poor SMEs via the RRBs and via the vocational schools, and especially in the space of, say, livelihoods, like let's take Gulbarga, you can actually look at two things. One is, how do you create a resilience of a plan B for people who are suffering with drought? It could be solar powered sewing machines, solar powered silk weaving machines, solar powered alternative livelihoods that are not only you get trained and innovated via the local ITIs and the vocational school like Rootsetis, parallelly given low cost R&D money via the RRBs, and then followed by low cost financing for working capital through the RRBs in those areas. And the second thing that's going to come up, Govind, is, and how do we look at a similar community-based entrepreneurship? In a sense, there's a lot of FPOs that are coming in, the farmer producer organizations. Similarly, how do you look at a community-based setups where the communities like FPOs, which are structured, start owning assets like cold storage, larger livelihood centers? That's going to be the key. How do we democratize the way, just like as you have IT industry that Anirudh Saab talked about, but in a much smaller case, have centers of livelihood centers where people come and use the tent space for a bakery or a where you common infrastructure for livelihood, bakery, sewing machines, blacksmithing.
Right. Okay. So I have a question to all of you. And before that, I do invite our panelists to pitch in. We are talking about reducing carbon footprint and the post-COVID-19 challenge. What does it mean for you and your companies or organizations? And how are you seeing this? Are you seeing this as a challenge? Are you seeing this as an opportunity? Do you have ideas about how we could use this effectively as we transition into this new world, if we do indeed? So the question I have to all of you, and let me begin with you, Mr. Agarwal. All three of you are in a way sitting at the top of the food chain. From a policy making point of view, from as entrepreneurs, as in senior members of a large company. How does all of this square off with the aspirations of Young India? With whom or on whom you in a way depend on to make this make some of these things successful or effective?
I think Young India is seeing this already. I mean, again, when I go from a mobility perspective, I mean, the big difference I see between Young India and my generation is that they are not carried away by their personal cars. They are much happier using an Uber or using public transport. They are not carried away by, I must have my own car to prove my status point or my sort of income status. So I think they are already in it. The big question I have, even though I completely agree with Harish in terms of this decentralization, I think that's a great idea. We have to think of how this can be taken forward. In many ways, it is really going back on what a lot of planners are talking about as compact cities being the order of the day. Now, today, that compact city paradigm may have to be rethought. And I completely agree with Harish. So it needs to really start thinking of, and there's no reason why this can't be done. The only challenge that may come up in this, and we have to think of how this can be handled, is for every kind of service that you deliver, there are certain economies of scale. For example, you won't have universities that are decentralized. You won't have airports that are decentralized. Yet these are important components of the entire set of services that people would need. Yeah. Can we think of some of them being done in some kind of a manner, even as that decentralizer happens? I'm completely in agreement that decentralization is really the way to go. Yet there'll be some of these things that we'll have to think of how this can be handled.
Okay, Dr. Agnew.
Yeah, so I think the way I look at it is not only from a carbon perspective, but I think it's a huge sociological change in my view. We are looking at people who were scrambling to get to office, say at 7 o'clock in the morning, 8 o'clock in the morning, going back late at home by 9 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, whatever. The huge commuting times that people used to take, I think now they're at home, and this is giving rise to a lot of issues, I would say, from a personal front. And we're getting to experience that, and I think a lot of things is also being out in the media, and what kind of changes are happening, what are people undergoing, who are bound to home. So I think if you look at the positive aspects, I think definitely there is a huge potential to actually scale it up, because people don't spend 2 hours each way going to office, and that time they can use productively at home, attending to personal chores, and doing a lot of personal stuff which they were probably missing out earlier. I think now currently the situation is a little fluid, because you don't have any house help at home, you don't have any babysitting functioning. So people are actually tasked with multiple things. They have to work for their productive time. They also have to take care of the household chores. But I think once the COVID situation eases and people are able to get the services back, I think things will settle down. And I think that is the time when we'll have to really look at how this is going to pan out. Right. Currently, people are stressed. A lot of them are stressed. Some people have managed to work around the barriers and are able to work effectively. So I think this is a very fluid stage in terms of understanding what is going on, and probably this period of maybe 3-4 months is going to generate a lot of information and data as to how to manage a remote working.
Are you monitoring this in any way? I'm talking about the mental health and
yes.
So, you are monitoring.
So we're running regular webinars on how to manage your household chores, how to take care of your ergonomic right. requirements while working from home, because a lot of people, and I'm saying that the young crowd, IT crowd who typically stays out of a rental home or as a PG, people have some challenges in terms of adapting to a work from home kind of a model. They don't have a table, they don't have a chair, and they're working sitting on a bed or whatever. So I think these are the issues which we are trying to understand now. So we have regular sessions with them on yoga, on mental well-being, on ergonomics, which kind of coaches them to adapt to the current situation. And I think that is giving us a lot of benefit. But this data obviously will feed into the next wave of the work from home kind of thing that we're going to work out. And I think that is going to be extremely valuable for us in terms of learning.
Okay, great. So let's start taking some comments and questions. Ajay Chandile says, it's not a question, but a remark. Countries like Vietnam already have thousands and thousands of two-wheelers, cycles, mopeds, and scooters. Cars are heavily taxed. They believe less in public transport, which is restricted to long distances. So the point to what Dr. Agarwal has said. Sanjoy Hazarika of the CHRI says, to all three panelists, Dr. Agarwal spoke of ensuring social distancing. I wish all of us would use the word physical distancing for obvious reasons. And better mobility. Micromobility carries with it a problem. Traffic in this country is unfriendly to smaller two vehicles, especially cycles. How would you, one, enable the cultural change that would make this possible? How do you and Dr. Agnihotri look at a rollout over the 1, 3, 5, 10 year period? And finally, to use climate change phrasing, it's all about adaptation and mitigation processes and implementation. So, Dr. Agarwal, do you want to go first?
First, Sanjoy's point, I completely agree. The term social distancing is not the right term to use. It should be physical distancing. Since we've got used to this figure of social distancing, I use that, but I completely agree. It should be a physical distancing. How this rolls out, even though we've been talking about what should happen, my concern is how long will this problem last? And my fear is that if it gets over in 3 to 4 months, will we just go back to our old ways and miss this opportunity? That's really the big concern that I have. Other than that, at this stage, no, nothing else. I might come back on one or two of these points.
Okay. The point about, being unfriendly to smaller two vehicles, especially cycles.
Okay. Let me, no, good. Okay. That's a good point. Let me also talk a little about Vietnam. You see, what happens in many countries where public transport systems have not been good, then people move from walking straight to the two-wheeler. This is what happened in Vietnam. And a large number of two-wheelers has been because the public transport system there were extremely weak. In India, they were not as weak as they were in Vietnam. That's why we do have some public transport and a fair share of two-wheelers. But the roads, frankly, this is a very good point that's been brought up. Our roads are really unfriendly to two-wheelers. Now, but part of that reason is if you have a certain limited width, how do you allocate that limited width between vehicles which travel at five different speeds? It's very difficult to do that. And our experience in Delhi with the bus rapid transit is a classic example of how influential people don't want their road space to be taken away. Now, think of what would happen if we start allocating space to two-wheelers to make it safe. That's the way it should be done. But what happens is it politically, do people have the guts to be able to do that kind of thing? In Delhi, clearly, that was not possible. And so that's why we...
Right. So let me add a quick question there, Dr. Agarwal. So from Ajit Patnaik, he says decentralization and work from home not be possible for all industries and all categories of workers and employees. Is it not time to invest in technologies that encourage low-cost solar-powered bicycles and encourage employees to go to work using that? It can be made mandatory by law too for use by all. Here is where you can also say as a lawmaker earlier whether this would work.
In fact, that's what I said during my opening presentation itself, that this is the time to think of vehicles like this. Completely agree, yeah.
Okay. A lot of our discussion in the post-COVID carbon footprint reduction world has been around mobility and work, particularly from home in the context of digital industries, if I can call it that. We've not really talked about much beyond that. But here's a question from James Abraham. He asks, does the C19 situation present an opportunity to shift our power infrastructure away from conventional to renewable? Or is this neutral to the transition? So, Harish, do you want to go on that first?
Yeah, I'll also pick up on a little bit of the Young India. India, how does it, from two parts. What is Young India in the urban and Young India in the rural areas? One is some of the complaints I have seen from the Young India today is that in all the webinars, it's always the old India speaking. I mean, they're not getting a chance at all. Absolutely not. And even in team meetings of companies, they're getting drowned out because it's mostly the senior guys speaking about it. And so it's a huge disadvantage to be young Indian right now, because you also call webinars only senior guys who have spent time. So it's not a good time for Young India to prove its leadership, because it's drowned out. You don't see the audience. It's no physical interaction. Who is becoming a leader? Who's not? Who is the next generation? But there also I thought, saying there is a very lack of crisis management thinking. So when I started using some of my friends who were in the and I found a lot of the IIT world people most useless. Because many of them...
Which means your other two colleagues as well on the panel.
Could not advise to a lot of the rural entrepreneurs. In a sense, because the crisis, a lot of the people in the urban areas were not accustomed to looking at how the rural businesses were held. I mean, receivables. And first of all, why don't you collect your receivables, Baba? The people who are supposed to give you money also are in the same position of a blacksmith not able to pay because he does not have business. He cannot pay. So don't say, it's easy to look at an Excel sheet, go and collect or go and negotiate. There is nothing called as negotiation. I think there's a lack of mentorship in how do you now create young India who can also relate to the crisis that's happening in the rural areas and the slum areas? And there's a very disconnect between that, I would say. And that is all what one needs to look at. In terms of the, once you look at decentralization, I think there is enough of data and enough of push for economics that show that solar, biogas and all makes so much of sense from a decentralized perspective rather than larger grids and electricity. So and where your planning process is in a stage wise, you do not have to actually depend on anything that's outside, whether it's oil, coal, or anything else. This is the time to move away from the centralization of grids and decentralization.
So you're saying it's an opportunity to shift our power infrastructure away.
Yes, absolutely.
Does anyone else want to weigh in on this, on the use of power? Dr. Atniyotri, I mean, you're also a large consumer, I'm sure, and you have diesel gensets all over.
Yeah, I think decentralization, like I talked about in the context of, you know, like people working in their own homes, and that's one form of decentralization. So we would probably, when we start rationalizing our campuses and our large campuses, then obviously the scale of operations would definitely go down. The kind of power that is required to power this huge mammoth campuses will go down. So I think in a way it is going to impact the power industry, and you know, the way we look at power as a, you know, centralized, you know, resource that is available. So that's basically the context that we would look at.
Right. Okay. Sanjoy Azarika has a lot of points. Thank you, Sanjoy, for being an active participant today. Let me pick up a question from, I think, a colleague of mine, Bhaskar Tripathi. He asks, and this is for Dr. Agarwal. The panel spoke about decentralizing planning and resources, but if anything has come out of the government's response to the pandemic, is that this opportunity has been used by power centers to centralize the planning and power. So how do you see that possibility in this context? And do you see the possibility of a big change in this atmosphere?
Well, I think it needs to happen. You know, yes, government is probably looking at it from a very central point of view because that's the way they have been doing it for some time. But for decentralized systems to evolve, they won't happen right away. It'll take that kind of time. So I would say that this is, again, something that will have to evolve. And it needs to.
Yeah, no, I think someone said it quite cruelly on a social media post, someone I know, saying that, you know, creating all these multiple, containment zones and then the timings and the curfews is a bureaucrat's wet dream, you know, and then managing it. So it is a mindset challenge that has a very strong possibility of migrating into this new world. So, I mean, I'm sensing a tension point there. I know you're not in government now, but...
No, but that doesn't matter. I think, you know, even in government, these things will take time to evolve. You know, people like Harish need to keep talking about it. That's sure. How, you know, the...
But I think to OP, but the question, what has happened is, we've got a lot of responses from whether it's on paper, but practically what's happening is a lot of the DCs are coming forward to look at opportunities in their own areas. How can the next set of health and livelihoods can happen? A lot of DCs have taken their own decisions to create livelihood centers and as well as health mechanisms for starting with Corona and saying that can we create hospitals for and beds for returning migrants or people who are affected, but has also started to think about livelihoods in a decent. So DCs, I mean, that means there's a decentralization of decision making that is automatically happening. People are realizing that we need to give options.
You know, in a situation like this where everything happened so suddenly,
right?
DCs didn't have the opportunity to talk to anyone else, but the problem was with them. As far as the people are concerned, the first point is the DC. So many of them reacted, and we've actually putting together a whole list of these examples. Many of these reacted. I think you shouldn't look at it only from the point of view of a certain place where everything is happening. Let's face it, a lot of the money today is at one place. And if that money has to be channeled down, decisions have to be taken at that level. But at least my own experience has been, and I've worked in Assam for so many years, when you have these floods and when you have a lot of these natural calamities that take place every year, a lot of the decision making is local. Responses are local.
Right.
So it's just that the flow of resources sometimes happen from a central point, where that's where our financial structures are centralized. But I think this will evolve.
Right. I think, no, it's a good point. I mean, I was interviewing Ajay Shah, the economist, and this was more than a month ago, where he was talking about, you know, the response to coronavirus and the urgent need for decentralization. Because, and that's the way it's evolved. We're talking about 13 centers where the battle has to be really fought and not the rest of the country. So the extension of that to say that can this decentralization need to lead to, let's say, the focus on livelihoods and the economy, the way Harish has been talking about. So it's using the good parts of decentralization to focus and use it for, forward thinking rather than administrative control. Am I right, Harish?
Yes, and can you imagine DCs are writing proposals to CSRs in what is their locality, what is that needed? I mean, so there is, they are looking, where can I raise money? So individual districts. So I think that's where, for example, the Meghalaya DC Swapnil has been demarcating and East Garo Hills completely, saying that livelihoods, health, education, what next for next 5 years? How can I look at it? So
right. That
is some sort of
thinking.
We just wish DCs would stay longer in their places. not the way it's happening today.
Right. Okay, so let me pick up another point Sanjoy makes, Sanjoy Hazarika, that is, he says, he wrote a piece in the Hindu last week, and he talked about using the Swachh Bharat network to strengthen cottage industries, which have been killed by huge industry, which cannot work at more than nominal capacity, give the latter incentives to buy from rural manufacturers and thus generate rural employment, not migration or distress, so that farm incomes are supplemented, equip and empower artisans with better skills, capacity and technology, access to capital and markets. And that's something that Harish has been talking about as well. Formalize work from home and design a migration plan. Support people to work in their states or near their cluster of villages so that they are not far from home, especially after this wrenching experience where employers have dismissed and disowned them, governments have failed them, and most NGOs and relief workers are the people who've come to their rescue. So Dr. Agnihotri, now your workers were obviously, your employees or people who work with you, particularly the younger India, and you talked about the crisscrossing. And so all the people are obviously crisscrossing within Bangalore or Mumbai, Chennai, Hyderabad, and so on, or Delhi. Now, how do you see this going forward? I mean, could you be relocating people? Because if they are going to work remotely, there's no real reason for them to be in the same city and do so.
Absolutely, absolutely. So I think this is going to impact the large amount of migration that used to happen. Because when you get placed in TCS, you complete your initial learning program, and then you could be placed anywhere in the country, or like initially in the country, of course, not abroad right away. So a person from Delhi would have to move to Bangalore, a Bangalore guy would have to go to Calcutta, and so on and so forth. So I think henceforth, it is not required. People don't have to move to a particular city to start working. They could be, in a different city, in their own home city, and they could still be working. They would be working on a project which is operating mainly out of Calcutta. And anyway, we had a very distributed model of projects also. So we had teams in 4 or 5 cities working on the same project. It was anyway, quite decentralized in that manner. But now even physical movement is not required. What we've seen also is that people can actually work from tier 2, tier 3 cities, or maybe from their own villages. A lot of people who have their hometowns in villages and smaller towns who don't yet have an IT campus can actually be working from their own homes, of course, subject to the infrastructure being provided to them. I think that is perfectly feasible. So I think we are looking at that, location agnostic kind of an approach, and this is going to immensely help in terms of the migration. I would not call that the migration that we experience, but I think what we're seeing also, the kind of migration where people, educated people move to cities, I think they could be very well be working from their home, hometowns and, home villages as well. So I think that is what is going to happen.
Right. And a quick question there. I mean, do you see an organization as yours playing an active role in that whole, in this entire process, or is it more passive?
Yes, of course. So when we announced this 25 by 25, so which means by 2025, we will have 25% of the people working from offices, the rest being working from home. And there is another 25 to it, that you are not bound to home for the entire year. You will be going to office 25% of your time.
Okay.
So it's not like complete blackout or complete out of the scenario from an office context. People will still be able to meet colleagues. People will be still able to go to office and so on. So this is going to be the thrust. So we're not going to encourage people to move to a particular location, to be productive. They could be working from their homes. I think a lot of infrastructure will have to be developed, which means I think the prime concern for an IT organization is the data privacy. Because we handle customer data, and I think data privacy is one of the important things, which has been built over a period of time. Now that has to be fast-tracked in terms of when you enable everybody to work from home. I think that's going to be one of the most important aspects that we will have to look at.
Right. Okay. So Ranjit Sinha says the government of India has already done in the past decades the decentralized way of micro-industries businesses in over 300 clusters spread over the entire country. But barring maybe 10% of those clusters like Tirupur, Badohi, Moradabad, most of those clusters planned for decentralized workplaces are not doing well. Harish, do you want to respond on that?
Yeah, I mean, the question is now, it's not going well because we had a complete absence of what you call it as inflow of qualified, not qualified in the way we look at qualified resources that were coming into those, and then the market linkages to those places were completely absent. No monies were put in. Now people will realize the importance of those clusters, and that is needed. That actually increases local employment in a larger way. I think with capital, that's going to change. The second question I just wanted to ask back to Dr. Anirudh, and as well going to you itself, this work from home saying 25 by 25, would it make difficult for other people to switch industries? Like, for example, who've been accustomed to working at home for so many years, they will not be able to join an industry like ours after working in an industry like yours for 15 years, because working from home has become so luxurious. And for us, it's not a choice. So do you think it's going to stifle cross-sectoral jumping of people?
I think it's going to be the case of grass greener being greener on the other side. So people who are homebound will aspire to be out there in the field and, you know, doing things with their own hands, because that is human nature. I mean, humans have been field people. I mean, this IT and this home concept is a recent thing. So I'm sure people who have been, you know, homebound for maybe 2 years, 3 years will aspire to go out, do things differently. I don't think that is going to be a barrier. This is only a privilege, I would say, where people avoid commuting. I think that is the biggest peeve that most people have. People enjoy being in office. I mean, they don't mind going to office except for the commuting part. So I think other than that, they're quite happy to be out.
If I can jump in here for a little bit. No, I think this is a very interesting point that Harish makes. But the way I would think of it is, you know, for many years, I have believed that, you know, the physical interaction that you have in a face-to-face environment has a lot of value that you don't get out of, you know, this work from home and a virtual kind of interaction. I remember working in the World Bank. I think most of the work, meaningful work of the World Bank, happened in the cafeteria, not in the meeting rooms, right? So the way I would think of this is, do we need to go to work 5 days in a week? Can it be something like, okay, you have a 2 day or a 3 day where you get to work? Or could there be a certain set of 4 to 5 hours when you are at work, but the rest of the time could be work from home? I think something in between like this may sort of help sort out the issue that Harish is very rightfully
raised. And I think the TCS formula seems to respond to that, saying that 25% of the time you have to spend in the office. Yeah. So that kind of balances out the social needs. Okay, we're running out of time. A quick comment from Shubham Agarwal, who says, India has been shifting strongly towards renewables and clean tech to improve environmental conditions post-COVID. With the very low price of oil, how can India stimulate a new wave of low carbon growth? What measures need to be taken in India and elsewhere to meet the Paris Accords? Does Mr. Agarwal or Harish, do any of you want to go on this?
Just fuel cost today is not going to cut it, because it's a combination of a supplier, a service and a product at the doorstep of the people is a combination of a lot of other factors. And that is going to become very expensive today, whether you talk about oil or coal or any, and that's where we are saying that renewables actually will score because of where it's produced and where you do not look at transport. And just like we are talking of working from home, and we need to look at producing from home also. So the question is, and renewables gives another edge of producing from home. So it's not just the cost of fuel, it's the cost of transportation, the cost of why is it actually needed at the end point, combination which pushes renewables to be a much better factor for a country like ours.
Okay, so we've run out of time, but you know, that's it's one of the many things that I'm taking away is clearly PFH, that's produced from home, in addition to work from home, or work from home to produce from home. We've spoken a lot about the post-COVID world from a carbon footprint. A lot of our discussions, because of the expertise that we have on this table, has been around mobility, at the rural decentralized workforce, as well as the corporate, the large behemoths, and how they will approach it. There is some discussion perhaps on the policy side, which is still to be done and is being done in separate panels. So I urge you to participate there. But in the meanwhile, thank you very much, everyone, for joining us. Thank you for sharing and quite candidly your thoughts. And also to my panelists for describing the challenges and opportunities in this new world. But it's in some happy measure that we've focused more on the opportunities and the need to move quickly towards them, whether it's in the villages or in the cities, or bringing these two together. So thank you very much once again for joining us. My thanks to Ananta Aspen Center for putting this together as well.
Thanks, Govind. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Govind. Thanks to everyone.